And then we dug up the SD chip, and it still worked. Compliments to the artist, I suppose. But sometimes you just might want to give up, you know? I could have just stayed home that day. And just to show you, these things don't come alone. Often they're broken apart, and there's a bunch of them, so sometimes you get crater chains. This is a chain of craters. It looks like carpet bombing in Vietnam. But what it is a series of parts of what was once a whole asteroid that had been broken up, and they're all traveling together. This is not the asteroid hitting different parts of the planet. Yes, it is that. But what of the moon? What this is they're all hitting the same spot in space, but the orb is rotating beneath it, taking every object and hitting it a little farther to the east. And so that's what happens in this image. So it's bad. And you know, we've got an asteroid headed our way. If there's time, maybe I'll get to it. Okay, I'll tell you about it now. December 2004, an asteroid was discovered on a collision course with Earth. They named it Apophis, after the Egyptian god of death and darkness. We only named it that because it was headed towards Earth. If it had a safe orbit out there, we would have named it something else. Like Tiffany, or Bambi, something not friendly, okay? Yeah. Any Tiffany's in the house? We named it Apophis. Apophis. Apophis is the size of the Rose Bowl. It's about 300 meters across, 3 football fields. And it's going to have a close approach to Earth in the year 2029, April 13th, which is a Friday, by the way. I felt some of your brain energy. I wonder if that's a Friday. It's a Friday. It's going to dip closer to Earth than our orbiting communication satellites. It'll be the biggest, closest thing we've ever observed in the history of our capacity to record historical events. It will not hit us. But depending on what it does do in that pass, we will learn whether it will hit us 7 years later on April 13th, 2036. Except that's a Thursday. Okay. So what are the odds of it hitting us? So for the April 13th, 2029, check it in or zero. We know the orbit, we've got the equations, we know what we're doing. It's zero, not going to hit us. Good place to view it is Northern Europe. That's when it will come by. You can check it out. I know some totally geeked out people who already rented hotel rooms. Okay, so the next one, you can calculate what the odds of hitting us are at the moment. The reason why it's not a certain number, that we give it a probability, it's because we don't know the orbit well enough to say for sure one way or the other. There's still uncertainties in the orbit. If we're uncertain on this direction, it'll hit us. Uncertain the other way, it won't. And you can compute the odds of that. And those odds are about 1 in 300,000. So you might say, oh, okay, what are you worried about? Is he not going to worry about 1 in 300,000? Okay. Well, okay. Let's compare this with some other probabilities. How about Tennessee Lottery, Mega Millions? How about that? What are the chances of winning that? 1 in 176 million. People play the lottery expecting to win. So, it is just next time you're tempted by the lottery booth, it is the student math book. It is fuck. It is 500 times more likely that you will get hit by asteroid Apophis than you will win this lottery. Okay? Just take that fact home with you. If Apophis hits, it will hit 500 kilometers due west of Santa Monica, California, in the Pacific Ocean. It will plunge to a depth of about 3 miles. At that depth, well, maybe 2 miles, it will explode at that depth, cavitating the Pacific Ocean. That will send a tsunami wave about 5 stories tall towards the west coast of the United States. But then there's a matter of this hole in the ocean. There's a wall of water that will fill it in catastrophically. It will splash up high into the stratosphere, fall back down, and create another wave. This rhythm will continue for about 45 minutes, on about a 45 second to a minute rhythm. What that means is that that first tsunami has to go back out to the ocean to get ready for the second tsunami. That's kind of cool, right? Okay, so it'll wipe clean the entire west coast of North America if it hits the Pacific Ocean. Now, well, someone's plotting there. State in Tennessee, right? Yes, the safest place will be the Appalachian Range, yes. So what happens is the water rushes in, it'll go in about a quarter of a mile. Then it's time to come back out again. And it brings all the homes with it back out, the million-dollar Malibu homes. It brings them all back out to the ocean. And then the next tsunami comes, and it brings the homes back in. In a slightly different shape. So this rhythm creates this churning, ablated, good word, because even if you don't know what it means, you feel what it means. The ablated forces of these churned up million-dollar homes will sandblast clean the entire west coast of the United States. And nobody has to die. Because we'll know this in advance. Just evacuate the west coast of the United States. And evacuate it only like a half a mile. Because you can put on the velvet rope and you can just watch the whole thing happen. You eat a burger. Is it done yet? Can I get back to my thing? No. I thought about it long and hard, and I think two people will die. Two people. The stupid surfer? Hey, man. I'm going to do this right. And he's dead. Right there. Dead. I'm saying, am I lying? You know these people out there. I'm like, man, I'm going to do this tsunami wave. Okay, dead number one. Dead number two. The weatherman who's always trying to get the camera back closer to the wave on the beach. Okay, so the camera keeps backing up. No, come in. Get a close look at the hurricane. Dead person number two. That's it. There's two people. I can accept that. So we actually have a plan on paper, it's not funded, to deflect. Yeah, live with that until that's the country we're in then, right? No one is like, yeah, it could be the end of civilization. Don't have to get reelected in a year, thank you. I got it. So we have a plan. There's several plans. One of them is to blow the sucker out of the sky. That's the macho guys. You know who they are, right? Those are the ones who like hitch up their pants, put in the chewing tobacco, says blow the sucker out of the sky. They got silos and nukes. So you can do that. Here's the problem. Here in America, we're really good at blowing stuff up, and less good at knowing where the pieces land. So that's the problem. So if you go blow this up, and now you got 22 pieces headed towards Earth, now you gotta evacuate whole swaths of continents. That's not good. So another plan is the kind of gentler method, and it's a gravitational tractor. You set up a spaceship, So the right ratio of size is like this microphone to my body. You set up a spaceship, and you sort of park it next to the asteroid. Now you can put the camera on me. Is that flippable right now? So people get a better view. Oh, there you go. Okay. Okay. So you have. So you bring the spaceship close to the asteroid. Now they want to pull towards each other. This is simple Newton's laws of gravity. But you don't let that happen. You fire retro rockets that resist the closing of that gap. Every moment you fire a retro rocket, you are slowly tugging the asteroid out of its orbit and out of harm's way. It's like a gravitational tractor. If you do it early enough, you don't have to move it by much. Not by much. Get it early enough, its diverted path accumulates, and then you can miss Earth entirely. We will know what kind of action will need to be taken in 2029. And that will give us 8 years to act. And we'll survive it as a species. It's not like the one that took out the dinosaurs. But we'll certainly lose every city on the West Coast. Now, life in the universe. There's a famous experiment back in the 1950s, the Miller-Urey experiment. What they do is you take some ingredients. This is stuff you have in the kitchen. Water, methane is in your stove. You may have a propane stove. Methane is a simpler version of propane, and they both have highly energetic. Ammonia, hydrogen, and an energy source. You throw in some sparks. This is common stuff in the universe. This is everywhere. You find these molecules, not just in your kitchen. The universe makes these all by itself. But can you make anything more complex? So in this flask, those ingredients were placed, as well as a spark that went across it, an energy source, and you let it sit there for weeks. You come back later, and you find that complex molecules were formed. You see, these molecules are simple, but stuff life is made of are complex. Amino acids, which are the building blocks of protein, the building blocks of life. And so in a couple of weeks, they made amino acids. So that's just a couple of weeks, and thanks to the fertility of the carbon atom, you have this kind of activity going on with a simple energy source. So it remains a mystery how you go from inorganic molecules organic inanimate molecules to organic animate life. But this is a very promising start. That in just a couple of weeks, with just some basic ingredients, complex molecules are formed. Another place I look for life is this place. I'm sorry, I don't have a picture of the whole orb, but this is the surface of Jupiter's moon Europa. This is ice that has frozen, broken, and refrozen again. And so what's fascinating here, I think, is that you can see places where the continuity of one of the previous cracks was shifted, almost like a fault line. Can you see that? This happens all over. These patterns we see in the ice caps of the Earth. We have ice flows that freeze and reconnect. It's this kind of evidence and other evidence that tells us that this ice is floating on an ocean of liquid water that's been liquid for billions of years, rendered liquid by the gravitational stress that Jupiter imparts upon it. Very similar to the heating that goes on in a racquetball. If you play racquet sports, you hit the ball for 5 minutes, that warms up the ball. Because you're stressing it, it pops back to shape, you stress it again. You're pumping energy into that ball. That's what Jupiter is doing to Europa. I want to go ice fishing on Europa. Cut a hole in there, look, see if life is swimming around. Because there's water there. And as I said earlier, any place on Earth you find water, you find life. Now, Europa, that's the name of one of Jupiter's moons. If you find life there, what do you call it? Have to be Europeans, right? That's what I want. Because it's Europa. I don't know. Maybe you have a better idea.